Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening, and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host. And before we even begin this evening's program, I would like to present these two checks to BCTV. The first, in the amount of $200, is from the Berks County Dog Training Club, and the other check is from the Berks County Kennel Club in the amount of $1,000. We support BCTV, and we hope you will too. Now, let's on with our guest. My first guest this evening, my first guest this evening is Barbara McLaughlin, and she has Viszlas. Talk about a weird spelling of a dog's name. These guys are from Hungary. Mm-hmm. Right. It's a Hungarian hunting dog.
Pointer.
Oh, okay.
They're a pointer. They retrieve. They do it all.
Okay. Are they different than other Hungarian, or does the Hungary only have one hunting dog?
Well, you don't know. No, they have... Great Pyrenees, they have...
But they're not hunting dogs.
They're not hunting dogs,
They don't have, like we have, how many different hunting breeds here in the United States, you know?
Weimaraner is German. These guys are hungry.
Right.
There's a little difference in their build and docking, temperament. But they were originally bred by royalty and literally smuggled out of the country after World War One. And just arrived in the United States in the early 50s.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. Okay, they've been here that long then.
Smuggled in.
Yeah, right. So, are they related to the Weimaraner?
No.
Okay.
No.
What?
I'm sure if you go back far enough.
Right. I just wondered, because they do look so much like, you know, the Weimy, that I thought maybe they might... Of course, the color is way different. Mm-hmm. I think, well, what is the Weimy called? The gray ghost or something like that. But they were bred for just this specific purpose as a... Is it a bird dog? It is a bird dog. Okay.
The purpose, like if we enter the hunt test that the AKC sanctions, the junior hunter, senior hunter, master hunter, basically they plant birds in the field. And then the dog has to find the bird, point it, and then we flush it out. And as the bird flies off, you shoot your cap pistol.
Okay.
And then the bird goes after it. I mean, the dog goes
after it. Yeah, the bird goes after it.
You need four passes to pass junior hunter. And they get tested on five things and have to have an average score of like 8 or 9 at least, or perfect 10. And then after junior hunter, there's senior hunter, which is a little more involved. It involves retrieving and honoring and shooting.
So then there, when you get into the senior hunter, then that's more than one dog in the field at a time?
Oh, yes. You always run in a brace with at least two dogs.
Okay. Even in the junior hunter?
In the junior hunter.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I didn't know
that. Which can be good or bad, you know, depending who you're running with.
Right, right, right.
You know, if they're well trained. And they have to be, you know, have a good recall, be good off leash.
Sure.
So when you call them, they come. And
right, right.
I've heard, a lot of people off in the woods calling their dogs.
Oh.
But it happens. Makes me feel good.
Yeah. Yeah, when your dog comes back and you're not one of those, right? So the bird is never hurt then? The bird is never...
No.
Oh, okay.
They're supposed to have a soft mouth.
Okay.
And she actually had a hunt test about a year ago. After the test was over, we went out in the field because there were a lot of birds left over.
Okay.
And she would find one, pointed it, actually picked it up in her mouth, ran around. You can hear them when they start to hunt.
Right. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You can definitely hear them snorking.
The nose starts working. Mm-hmm. And she found a bird, and she ran around with it and then dropped it, and the bird ran off. And then she went and got it again, ran around with it again.
So do they have their wings clipped then, that they can't fly?
No.
Oh.
They fly. But it's desired to have a soft mouth. You know, You get disqualified if you eat the bird.
Right, but I just didn't know how, you know, if the bird, how does the bird come down? They point it, and then you shoot your cap pistol, but
You flush the bird, and then as the bird takes off, you shoot your cap pistol, and the dog associates the cap pistol with something fun.
Okay, okay. But they don't ever have to retrieve that bird that you supposedly shot.
Not in junior hunter.
Okay, okay.
As you get up to senior hunter and master hunter.
Okay. So. I just wondered if the bird was killed so that the dog could bring it back to, you know, to hand.
No, in senior hunter they retrieve, but junior hunter they just it's just their basic natural instinct.
Right.
You know, to point it and to chase.
Right. Because the bird is not going to sit there and say, you know, here I am, come and pick me up.
Well, they do what they say, put them to sleep. There's a way you can sort of shake them
with
their head tucked, and then you plant them.
Okay.
And they just sort of lay there for a while, and then when the bird points them, it wakes them up, and they take off.
Oh, okay. All right. Oh, yeah, wow.
I've lost a lot of quail because I'm not real good at putting them to sleep.
And they're so cute anyway.
Yeah.
But not having a hunting dog yet, it's a whole new, mm-hmm. you know, performance event for me. I've never actually even seen. Now, I've seen some beagle trials, but that's totally different than, you know, the pointing dogs. Yeah.
We do field trials, too, for Viszlas, and then they're on horseback.
Okay.
That's different. That's a different
way of
training. But
yeah, I think the German shorthairs are hunted on horseback.
Right.
Yeah.
And so the small game isn't out there like it was years ago. Pheasants are, you know, usually not nearly as abundant. We're grateful for the sanctioned hunt tests that we can get them
what
they were bred to do.
That's exactly right.
And they're supposed to be known to go right from the field to the bed. You know, they're perfect, you know, family dogs.
Wash and wear.
High energy.
Yeah, high energy, but wash and wear.
Yeah.
Now, are they easy to train? You're saying they come back, but are they easy to train that, you know, they're going to be amenable to your commands and pay attention to you? Or once they get in the field, that's it, and they basically become deaf?
I guess that can be dependent on the dog.
Okay.
I was afraid to try her off lead, and the problem was opposite. She wouldn't leave my side.
Oh.
So she has to branch out if she's going to find the bird.
That's exactly right.
You know, so I'd have to try to ignore her, and finally she felt more comfortable, and she started, you know, branching out, and then that's the only way you're going to find the birds.
Right.
But it depends on the weather, the conditions, the air, you know, if it's humid.
Yes.
You know, how much scent they're going to be able to pick up.
Right. That's exactly right. And anybody doing tracking or nose work would understand that, you know, scent work would understand, you know, that the conditions mean a lot. Believe me, conditions mean a lot. But now, do they come in other colors or they only come in red?
They're rust.
Rust. I'm sorry.
They come in different shades of rust. Darker, too dark, or mahogany is a disqualification.
Really?
Too much white. They're allowed to have a small fist on their chest and on their toes, not to go above the first knuckle. So
Okay.
No, what you see is what you get. That's their color.
Okay.
Some are darker and lighter.
They also have their tails docked.
At 1/3 off.
Okay.
And for 2/3.
What purpose?
Mainly for the field work, you know, because they do get very excited and their tails really do wet.
Okay,
and
so actually it's for a health reason.
It's part of the standard, too, and the dew claw.
Yes.
If you've ever had a dew claw get ripped, that's nasty. And the time they spend in the field, the tail is ideally won't get injured.
Right, because their tails aren't really curved over their backs. They're sort of straight up.
They're supposed to be right over.
Right, right. And yes, I guess, you know, having that last bit of tail, which is basically, you know, the fine bones at the end of the tail. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would assume that
like it... Like a little whip.
Right. That's exactly right. So are these dogs good protectors? Are they, you know, they're such a, like a golden retriever, such a friendly dog. It's not really... It'll bark, but it's not gonna, the same with the labs, it's not a guarding type dog.
They bark.
Uh-huh.
She just follows me all around the house.
Oh, okay.
She's, you know, just my sidekick, and I've never been in a situation, you know, where I've had to depend on them to protect me.
Right, right.
So I don't know, but they do bark, and... You know, it's sometimes easier to contain them, you know, when somebody does come to the door.
But. Right, right. So, obviously, they need a fenced yard.
Oh, obviously.
Yes.
It's a...
Yes. They require a lot of exercise?
Yes, they do. And not just physical exercise, you know, mental...
Mental stimulation as well.
Mental stimulation, games, you know, they... they're very smart.
Okay.
And... they will get into trouble if they're
left to their own devices.
Yeah.
Would they be a good dog though for an older couple? I can imagine for a family with children, they'd be great. But what about a retired couple? Would this be a good dog for them?
I have sold. I don't breed often, but yes. The people that have had Vishlas and had puppies and are familiar with the breed, I don't think I would sell a Viszla puppy to somebody who wasn't familiar, who was older and not familiar with the breed.
Okay, okay.
Because
of the exercise
because
requirements?
Because of the exercise and the running and the
Would they be content with walking a couple of times a day?
Mm-hmm.
Would they
sure.
be good in an apartment?
It works if it's up to the owner.
Okay,
it really
okay.
is up to the owner if they're going to, you know, put that puppy on an elevator and take it out.
Right,
you
right.
know, walking, or they have some kind of setup in their apartment indoors.
Okay.
But
what health problems do they have?
Unfortunately, cancer is prevalent in the Viszla.
Really?
You know, so I always recommend people not use lawn chemicals or, you know, minimize the chemicals even on their skin. I don't.
Right.
Use the chemicals.
The phleantic stuff. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
There's a history of epilepsy. That's why as reputable breeders, you study pedigrees, you go back, you talk to people who've been...
Don't get too far away from your microphone.
who've been in it longer than you and know what problems are behind these dogs. And it enables you to pick a stud that hopefully does not have...
The genetic problems.
The genetic problems.
Right. Right. Yeah.
But, you know, it happens.
Right. Well, it happens to us.
Yeah, so. Exactly.
Right. Okay, well, I think we are finished with you, sweetheart. So we're going to have our second guest come in.
Thank you.
Uh-huh. Deanie Ruch, and she has a Netherlands Kooikerhondje. See if I got it right. She probably is not listening. Can't wait until we can go back to two people in the studio at one time. A way smaller hunting dog. So why are you hacking?
Just gave him a cookie.
Oh, you swallowed it whole, huh?
I think so.
So this is a...
A Netherlands Kooikerhondje.
Oh, a Kooikerhondje. I pronounced it wrong. I said Quaker.
Well, it's supposed to be koi like the fish, Kooikerhondje.
Okay. Well, I did get it pretty close. And this is a...
He is a toller.
Okay.
So he tolls. They toll for ducks along the canal in the Netherlands.
Okay. What is tolling?
Tolling means they walk along the canal and they play by the water, and the ducks like their fluffy tails, and they follow their fluffy tails. So they really aren't much of a hunting dog. They play.
Oh, okay.
So they do not retrieve. They do not hunt.
They don't point. Okay.
So they walk along the canal and they play. So. And the ducks follow them into the endercoy, which it's kind of like wooden baffles, and it gets smaller and smaller and smaller, and the ducks go in there.
Almost like a funnel then.
Kind of.
Okay.
They're made different ways, but because they're from the 1500s, they're mostly wooden.
Uh-huh.
So they're wooden baffles, and it just looks, I can't even describe it. It just looks like pieces of wood fencing. And then there's vegetation around it, and the ducks follow.
Oh, so it goes crooked. It's not a straight.
However the canal goes.
Oh. And so this is a fencing in the canal.
In the canal.
Oh, okay.
They just play, and they... And the ducks follow
them.
Well,
are the ducks in the canal then?
Yeah.
Or they do go in the canal or just run along the side?
The ducks are usually in the water, and these guys run along the side of the water.
Okay.
So they kind of work independently.
And
they just follow
wherever
the Kooiker, which is the man, the canal man, they follow the Kooiker to where he wants them to go, so they lead the ducks into a smaller and smaller area. And in the 1500s, that was how they hunted. Then they tagged them and took them to market or whatever they wanted to do with them.
Oh, okay.
But then after gunpowder was invented, they didn't really need these guys.
Right.
So then they became the guard dogs for the ducks. They guarded the ducks.
Oh, okay.
So it's a very small guard dog, but...
Well, if it's only guarding a duck, it doesn't need to be very large.
Which is why they don't retrieve, because the ducks are almost as big as them.
Yes.
So they play.
Okay.
So I'm. He's a different kind of sporting dog.
Yes, most definitely, he's a different kind of sporting dog. So actually, the Kooiker trains the dogs to follow him so that they can lead the ducks. So it's almost like a herding dog.
Well, they call them the Pied Pipers because they're the only sporting dog that works in front of their prey.
Okay.
They don't ever work behind or aside.
Okay.
They're always in front.
Okay.
And they when they go down to the water, they just play. They ignore the ducks.
Oh. Huh.
It's really interesting. I watched a couple of videos, but we even tried it with his mother the other year. And she just went down to the water and just walked along the water. And the ducks were over there. And she's like, come on, guys.
So they just do this naturally.
This apparently is
just a natural instinct.
Yeah, we haven't tried him yet. But
Wow. Now, there is another tolling dog, the Nova Scotia Duff Tolling Retriever.
And I've read two different theories on that these guys came from the tollers, and I've also read that the tollers came from them. But if you look at them, they're very similar looking.
Oh, yes, they are very similar.
But the tollers have more red than white.
Okay.
And they're larger.
And
they retrieve.
Okay, yes.
Some of them.
Yes, they do retrieve.
Yeah.
But the tollers also don't have the dark markings. I don't think they're as striking.
As
the Kooikers are. I think the Kooikers with their black markings around the face and the dark eyes and, you know, the masks, it makes them look much more striking than the Nova Scotia tollers.
Right. Yeah. There are several Nova Scotia people that have tollers.
Okay.
Or are trying to get one.
Oh, okay. Okay. So then they're not very popular.
The Kooikers?
Mm-hmm.
They're getting more popular, but they're not the easiest breed to own.
Okay.
Because they are high energy.
Mm-hmm.
They are very independent because that's what they were taught for hundreds of years, was to be independent and work independently of the Kooiker.
So then they're a little more difficult to train?
They're very smart.
Mm-hmm.
But yes.
Okay.
there, you have to work harder.
Yes, yes, for them to do your bidding, correct?
Yes, they are very independent. They're very playful, as is what they're supposed to be. And they love to play. And we have found that we have two of them now, that it's actually good to have two, because they play with
each other. Keep each other busy.
And they'll wrestle all day and roll around on the floor and in the grass and play with the ball.
So this would actually not be a good dog for a retired couple then?
Well, I am retired. Yeah. I would say it would not be a good dog for a first-time dog owner.
Okay.
Because this dog will control you.
Oh, okay.
Completely control.
Well, they're so cute, and that's usually what little dogs do anyway.
Correct.
You know? Right.
Correct, yeah. Yeah.
But do they come in any other colors or just the red and white?
Well, they're supposed to be just the red and white.
Okay.
Occasionally you get one that has more black.
Uh-huh.
Because in order to get the black pigment with the ears.
Yes.
And the tail, around the tail, they have to be born with black.
Okay.
So sometimes some of them do not lose their black.
Oh. Okay.
But the correct coloring is a white and red dog.
Okay.
A very happy white and red dog.
A very happy. So they would be good with kids, though, right?
Sometimes. If they grow up with children, they like children.
Oh.
But if they have not grown up with children, they don't always like children.
Oh, that's interesting. Since they are playful, you would think that, you know.
You would think.
It'd be a great combination.
Yeah. His mother is afraid of children. She backs up.
Oh, really?
She's afraid, and he doesn't seem to care.
Huh. But. Interesting. Very interesting. So what medical problems do you have with this breed, since they're not popular?
There's very, very few medical problems. They have the von Wilburns.
Oh, von Wildebrandt's, the bleeding disease.
Yes,
yes,
they have.
Yes, hemophilia.
Yeah, that is in the breed, but it's nearly bred out now.
Good.
But there's very little else.
What about the kneecaps, since it is a smaller dog? Do they have any problems with the slipping kneecaps?
We do check that.
Okay.
That's part of what you have to do for the breed, is you have to have the hips, the knees checked. We check the eyes.
Okay.
Also, because he's from the Netherlands and it's a fairly new breed to the United States, they require that we register all of our dogs in the Netherlands.
Really?
Plus, we have to send a blood sample, we have to send the blood sample to the Netherlands.
Wow.
And they do all the testing, and they register the dog in the Netherlands.
Okay. So they do the testing, but what, in case you want to breed that dog, they have the testing?
I think, and it's to make sure that everything is the way it's supposed to be with the breed. But, yeah, we had to send a vial of blood over to a university in the Netherlands.
Wow.
We have not done his yet. When they're about two, we do it.
Okay.
But we did do his mother, and everything came back good, and she's registered in the Netherlands.
Hmm.
Their registry goes back hundreds of years.
Yes, yes. A lot of the countries over in Europe have better record-keeping, let's put it that way, record-keeping than actually the United States does. You know, we have a couple of many more organizations now than when I first started in purebred dogs, that the breeders are doing considerably more testing, more genetic testing.
Right.
Because we just didn't know. There was no way to do it years ago.
When we bred his mother, we had to go through a registry to run the coefficient to see what stud dog would be with her. So we
was
had
that
to
in go, the United States or we, over in the Netherlands?
We went through the club, our club president.
Here in the United States.
Okay. Yes, okay. They live in Illinois.
Okay.
And they ran a coefficient for us, and they came up with three males in the United States that we could breed to.
Oh.
Because at one time, this breed had almost died out. So you have to be very, very careful, because a lot are related.
Yes.
So every so often, somebody goes over to the Netherlands and brings new stock
over.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
His all of his grandparents are not from the United States.
Okay.
He has one from Sweden and two from the Netherlands.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, and I'm not sure where the other one's from, but they were all imports.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep. Yep.
But so, temperament on these guys are, you know, they're really good with other dogs. They're good with people.
They are a little wary of people, and they are wary of other dogs. His mother does not like when another dog misbehaves.
Oh.
That upsets her.
Oh, okay.
He doesn't seem to care a whole lot about anything.
He's a boy dog. You know? Boy dogs are just, people don't understand. They always say, oh, I want a female.
No.
But females are not the easiest to live with. The boy dogs are just so laid back.
Yeah.
And so, whatever. You know, they're really cool. And people are, oh, no, I don't want a male. You know, they're going to lift their legs. Well, yeah, if that's the only problem you have, you don't have the barking, you don't have the growl, you don't have any of the other stuff, you know.
No.
It's like, yeah, give me a boy.
His mother has to guard our yard every day.
Oh.
She walks around the fence and checks to make sure everything's okay. And he plays.
Yeah.
He just plays.
Oh, my word.
But he's very laid back. His daddy is very laid back.
Well, that's good. He is a cutie. He really is a cutie. It's a nice breed. Too small for me, but it's a nice breed.
It is a nice breed. It's just, there's a lot of shedding.
Oh, well, you have more coat.
I know.
They do have the double coat, right?
Yes,
there's
a lot of coat.
Right, well, you know, it's only a little dog, so you can't have that much shedding.
Want to bet?
Yeah. It's not like my guys.
I know.
But, yeah, well, it's only that the white hair gets on your brown and black clothes and the red, yeah. That's exactly right. Well, thank you very much for bringing Buster on. And I guess that's our program for this evening. Next month, I'm going to have a really interesting breed on. I tried to get her before, and it just didn't work out. So we're going to have a Bergamasca. Now, you can all look that up on your computers and find out what it looks like, but we'll have one for real here next month. So for this evening, good night.
All About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.